I am E. Foley.
And I'm B. Coates, but we are also, as Liz. You said, Liz and Beth.
And we're here to talk about what would Boudicca do, everyday problems solved by history's most remarkable women.
So it's been a really amazing year for the sort of amplification of women's voices, particularly in the UK with this centenary year of women's suffrage.
And it's also, as part of that, there has been lots of raising awareness of the achievements of women from history that have perhaps in the past been kind of let slide a little bit. And we're, you know, very much endorsed the theory of if you can see it, you can be it. And so our book is designed kind of to help women deal with problems that might come up today, even though the women themselves are actually from times far back in the past. We have chapters on women from different cultures, from different backgrounds, covering lots of disciplines. So we have sportswomen, women involved in science, in literature, in piracy.
We know it's a really noisy conversation, this conversation about women right now, but we wanted to take the stories one step further and see if they could actually help us in our daily lives.
So the way our book's organised is it's divided into 50 short chapters, and each chapter focuses one particular high achiever from the past, and each of them answers a very specific problem. And some of those problems are serious, and some of them we're being slightly more lighthearted with. So we have Mae West on body positivity, we have Emily Dickinson on defying FOMO, we have Grace Hopper on facing up to failure,
and Grania O'Malley, who's our pirate, is on work-life balance. But we're obviously here in a in the middle of a working day, so we wanted to look at certain women who might help us in certain dilemmas that might come up in the working office life.
So we start with someone who is very famous for being very good at her job.
So Elizabeth I is somebody that I channel daily, and particularly at this exact moment in time, because we're talking about her in relation to public speaking. Okay, so dry mouth.
Yep.
Sweating palms.
Yep.
Voice all weird, squeaky and high.
Really trying to counteract that.
Well, most of us approach public speaking with a rising sense of dread, it's true. But if we can learn to sort of fight the fear, the rewards are very rich. And also it's worth just noting that pretty much all of us are going to have to do it at some stage during our lives. Elizabeth I had a very tricky start in life. She was a toddler when she was banished from court by her father, Henry VIII, who also accused her mother, Anne Boleyn, of adultery and had her beheaded.
Which is kind of excellent dad skills to start you off with.
But nevertheless, she became queen in 1558 after her sister died. And she inherited a country that was completely divided by religious conflict. So her first job was to reinstate Protestantism. And she had to use all of her sort of persuasive interpersonal skills and a very stage-managed sense of authority to achieve what she achieved. So within 1 year, she'd got rid of the Pope as the head of the Church of England, installing herself naturally in that place. She'd re-established the Church of England as well, and she basically had taken a decision not to force her subjects into religious conformity, which was what her sister had done.
So Mary before her had done that with a lot of burning and murder involved, and Elizabeth was clearly hoping to end up with a better epithet than bloody.
Bloody Mary is what she was called. So Elizabeth was wildly clever, we know this. She was fluent in French, Greek, Italian, Latin. She enjoyed translating the classics in her spare time. She composed sonnets as well in her third time. Basically, she was a massive overachiever. But even for someone like her, it must have been pretty tough to walk into Parliament and express herself in a room full of much more politically savvy men. And I think what she was really good at was putting on a sort of imperial show. And this is another thing that she sort of harnessed in her working life, which we can do. One of her sort of big hobbies was drama. So under her, there was this great flowering of sort of English literature and drama. Of course, Shakespeare and Spenser, but also people like Thomas Kidd and Christopher Marlowe as well.
Yeah, and that's actually something that comes up in lots of kind of modern guides to public speaking, is that watching actors perform is a really good way of you know, honing presentation skills. So she was doing that all the way back.
Yeah. So obviously her private life was a matter of great public interest, and she had many suitors, and she was known as the Virgin Queen. And at one point Parliament got incredibly jumpy about the succession of the throne, and they threatened to take away her allowance, essentially. So she used her sort of rhetorical moxie in that instance, and she made one of her great speeches and her best cross voice, and she said, "At present it is not convenient, nor never shall be, without some peril unto you and certain danger unto me." So she was brilliant at holding off Parliament and also suitors, but she was also good at holding off her threats from abroad, most famously against the Spanish Armada in 1588. She appeared, there's this brilliant moment where she appeared with the troops at Tilbury in full regalia. She had this real genius for sort of grandstanding and swashbuckling.
Yeah, and she turned up in a long white velvet gown with armour on a grey horse to make her red hair look particularly good. And what she was doing there was very visibly channeling Boudicca from the past, and we talk a bit about Boudicca later.
Yeah. So she was. This was like the ultimate kind of motivational speaker. She placed herself sort of with her troops to G them up, and the speech was amazing. So she uses this great line where she says, "I know I have but the body of a weak and feeble woman, but I have this heart and stomach of a king, and a king of England too," which is a sort of brilliant humble brag in some ways. She's sort of acknowledging what the troops might have been thinking, like, "Are we being led by a woman?" But at the same, in the next sentence, completely subverting it and saying, "I am your leader." She also knew when to deliver a bit of sort of emotional sweet talk in a public way. Her final farewell to Parliament is known as the Golden Speech, and it basically made them all cry, which we think is a great send-off. We're not going to do that today. But she said to them, "Though you have had many princes more white, mighty and wise sitting in this seat, yet you have never had any more careful and loving." So we think maybe the next time we're trying to do a tricky presentation to our line managers, we can remember the tough crowd that Elizabeth was facing. For her, her reign was known as the Golden Age. I mean, that might be too much to pull off as your tenure in the accounts department, but hey, it's a good thing to aim at. And finally, we have some tips
from Elizabeth. So first thing is think about presentation. Obviously, wear white velvet at all opportunities.
Alcohol in small doses does no harm. And also remember that worst things do happen at sea, particularly obviously if you're the Spanish Armada. And most of the time, 99% of people watching are willing you to smash it. So, or they're just thinking about their dinner. So either way, it's not something to
get. We're fine either way.
Exactly.
So the next person we wanted to talk about is someone who was also very good at putting on a good show. And this is 1930s screen siren Hedy Lamarr, who was known in her day as the most beautiful woman in the world. And she was so beautiful that people found it quite difficult to believe that there was anything much going on behind her gorgeous green eyes. We talk about her in Knowing Your Worth because we love Hedy. She pursued her work passions in the face of much naysaying and resistance. And she was an actress, both an actress and an inventor, and the inventor part of her life has had a lot more coverage recently, and she's been celebrated for that more. Although still with a lingering sense of surprise that someone who looks so good could be so clever, particularly if they're a woman, I think.
Because we all know women are rubbish at science, as well as fighting, parking and barbecues.
So, Hedy was born in 1913 in Austria, and she grew up in a cultivated and comfortable home, and she went to drama school in Berlin. And after that, she got her first big break, and it was sort of like a highbrow version of the Kardashian sex tape, because she was involved in a Czech film called Ecstasy, which was the first widely released film to have an explicit sex scene in it, which was banned in the US, it was denounced by the Pope. Her parents went to the premiere and had a very uncomfortable time. It's very sweet, actually, by modern standards, although Hedy does run around starkers in it. And there is a famous scene where she's acting out the sexual ecstasy of the title, which apparently was achieved by the director poking her bum with a pin in order to get the desired effect, which is quite a disturbing way to deal with a teenage colleague. But it did launch her on her celebrity career path.
She had something really interesting to say about that career path, where she defined it as, she said, "The ladder of success in Hollywood is usually a press agent, actor, director, producer, leading man, and you're a star if you sleep with each one of them in that order." Which is kind of extraordinary that she was saying that 50 years ago and feels very depressingly familiar to us.
Yes. Hedy's newfound starlight was quite quickly snuffed out by her possessive husband. He was a wealthy fascist arms dealer, and he was not keen on people watching his wife in this film, so he rounded up all of the prints to destroy them. And Hedy soon tired of his controlling ways, and she legged it. One night, apparently, according to her story, dressed as a maid, she snuck out of their castle and ran away to London. And whatever the truth of that, it is a good feisty background story to give herself to make herself stand out against the other kind of wannabe starlets that she was up against at that point.
She was really good, I think, like Elizabeth I, at using storytelling and building a narrative to make you stand out, exactly.
By 1938, she was cast in her first English language film, and from that point on, she found herself mainly cast in seductive, exotic kind of roles, which she became a bit bored with to the point where she started her own company so she could avoid it. But in 1949, she went back into the kind of low-cut gowns for Cecil B. DeMille's Samson and Delilah, which was an enormous hit.
Yeah, it was a film. So Groucho Marx said about it, I'm not interested in a film where the man's tits are bigger than the woman's, which is a kind of, again, bit depressing thing to say about the women's role on the silver screen in the golden age of Hollywood.
And Hedy was certainly not just TNA. She had a singular brain inside her head. And when World War II came, she was very keen to be involved in the war effort. And she had, while living with her ex-husband, she'd picked up quite a lot of knowledge about armaments.
Yeah, so essentially whenever the Third Reich came to dinner, she was there just having a good old listen to what they were talking about.
And she teamed up with a pianist called George Antile, and together they developed a frequency hopping radio device to help missiles get through German defences, which they donated to the Navy for free, the patent for free, but it was not exploited at that time. But I think, as most people know now, it has become, that technology has become part of Wi-Fi and GPS and things that we use all the time now. And Hedy really loved inventing things. It was like her proper top hobby. She applied to the National Inventors Council, but they rebuffed her. But she used to, when she was on film sets, sit and tinker away. She invented new designs for traffic signals, a fluorescent dog collar, a tissue box, and also an idea for a powdered fizzy drinks cube that you could drop into your water to make yourself Coke. But people were much more interested in her six marriages and her later scandalous behaviour, which included lawsuits and extreme plastic surgery. And her kind of eccentric hobby didn't really fit with the marketing of her as a kind of Hollywood sex symbol. And so it was not until she was 84 that she was recognised as an inventor, and that's when she and George were given Pioneer Awards from the Electronic Frontier Foundation.
And she said brilliantly, well, it's about time.
So no one could rock a centre parting, a bold lipstick and an elegant understanding of spread spectrum broadcast like Hedy. Thank you. But the important thing we felt we learned from her story was to follow our own interests, even if others can't see the point. She was brilliantly clear on where she attributed her own value, so she was very proud of being an inventor, but she famously said of the glitzy bit of her career, any girl can be glamorous. All you have to do is stand still and look stupid.
So next up we have Odette. So Hedy's involvement in the war was undoubtedly patriotic, but it was kind of at a distance. We have some women in our book whose involvement in war was really visceral, very close up, and Odette's one of the first ones. We talk about her in terms of being open to experience and not being afraid of our mistake. So it's the parallel we make in the book is, you know, that feeling when you press reply, you think you've pressed reply and you've actually pressed reply all and you've sent something about your colleague to the whole floor. Well, for Odette, she made a kind of mistake like that, and it changed her life kind of completely. And what we wanted to think about was, instead of when you send that email locking yourself in the loo and thinking, oh my God, if you could think of a way to keep your chin up and be brave and try and learn to learn from your mistakes rather than be completely cowed by them. Yeah, for her, it had life-changing, amazing repercussions.
Which is good news for all of us who make that mistake on a regular basis.
So she was born in 1912, her dad in France, and her father had been a decorated hero in World War I. He was killed in World War I, and every Sunday her grandfather took her to his grave and said, if war comes again, it's your duty to do what your father did.
Which I think today's child psychologists would have a field day with that, but Odette was made of stern
stuff. She was. So then she married a British guy and she moved to London. And then when the Second World War broke out, her husband enlisted. And then the Battle of Britain and the Blitz has kind of reduced London to a real proper war zone. So she moved to Somerset with her mother-in-law and by now three small children.
So again, stern stuff to go and live with your mother-in-law and three small children,
yes,
by yourself.
Absolutely. She was in Somerset when she heard a BBC broadcast asking for holiday photographs from northern France, because the Luftwaffe controlled French airspace, and the Brits were trying to figure out a way to map their bombing raids. So she sent this letter saying that she knew the area like the back of her hand, but she misaddressed it. She sent it to the Admiralty, which is where it should have gone, but she sent it to the Navy, and they then passed it on to the Army, who then passed it to the SOE, the Special Operations Executive, and they immediately thought this woman would make an amazing spy. But what they were worried about is, you know, she was a woman, she had three small children, how would she cope if she was captured and tortured? again, you know, they couldn't know that she would prove to be as hard as nails.
And in fact, that three small children can prepare you to resist torture.
Exactly.
we both had three small children.
So Odette did agonise, but eventually her sort of horror for what was going on in her beloved home country won out. So she began training and she learned all the good stuff. Morse code, how to handle firearms, self-defence, resisting interrogation.
And her final report was glowing, but it did note a complete unwillingness to admit that she could ever be wrong, which is a strategy that is worth bearing in mind if you ever are dealing with the fallout from emailing an error.
Yes. So Odette was now Agent S23, and she was dropped into northern France to work for a man called Peter Churchill in a resistance group. Very quickly, they were betrayed by somebody inside the group, and she was handed over to the Germans. And they got very confused by this Peter Churchill situation. They thought he was a relative of Winston Churchill, and Odette was very happy to go along with that. They tortured her horribly. There are descriptions of what happened to her. She had her toenails ripped out. She was burnt on her back with hot irons, but she stood completely firm and didn't squeal. So eventually the Germans sent her to Ravensbrück concentration camp. And the commandant there, again, had heard this story about Peter Churchill, who she claimed they were in a relationship, and the fact that he was Winston's relative. So he thought he had kind of hostage gold on his hands. And when the Allied forces were closing in, he took Odette in his car with the plan to hand her over to as a bargaining chip, essentially, to the Americans.
That turned out to be a bad plan from the commandant, because Odette immediately dobbed him in and she stole documents from his car, and she then later testified against him.
Mm. So amazingly, Peter Churchill also survived the war, and when they came back to London, Odette divorced her husband and married Peter, so she did get her Mr. Churchill in the end. Mm-hmm. She was awarded an MBE, and she was the first person to be awarded the George Cross for gallantry. She died in 1995 at the ripe old age of 82, and she's just this brilliant icon of bravery and resistance and all-round hard-as-nails womanhood, and all because of a mistake. So I think the lesson we took from her is that, you know, if something goes wrong for you, think about your reaction. It's our sort of ability to deal with the situation when there's a massive cock-up, which kind of makes us potentially better human beings. And actually, aiming for constant perfection probably leads to massive unhappiness.
So we move from one warrior woman to another, our title lady, many centuries before Odette. So what happens if the pursuit of your passion, like Hedy, and your openness to opportunity, like Odette, leads you into conflict with others? So women in particular suffer cultural pressure to be agreeable at all times. And we talk in our book about how lucky we are to have had women like Rosalind Franklin, like Cleopatra or Coco Chanel, difficult women as they were called, forging an alternative path. But this pressure does still remain. And our next subject is Boudicca on sticking up for yourself.
So she's Norfolk's best known queen. She's a woman from history who totally stepped outside of the lane of what was expected of a lady. Her reputation sort of rests on her unusual levels of assertiveness, or what you might call bloodthirsty, revenge-fueled aggression. Anyway.
So Boudicca's story is full of holes and legendary embellishments, but it's generally agreed that she was the chief of the Iceni tribe in East Anglia about 2,000 years ago. After the Romans invaded Britain, they made an agreement with her husband that he would be able to continue to govern his own people very generously. But when he died, that gentleman's agreement did not extend to the ladies, and they immediately took Boudicca's land, and not content with just that, they also publicly flogged her and raped her children. This is all according to their historian Tacitus, and he's the best source that we have for what Boudicca then did. So instead of being cowed by this or accepting the inevitable sexual violence that comes to women in situations of conflict, Boudicca set the world on fire. She led a full-on revolt, and she burnt the cities of Colchester, St Albans and London to the ground, killing almost all the inhabitants, both Roman and Briton. And she almost managed to wipe the 9th Legion, I think, off the face of the earth as well.
Yeah, and there's that brilliant fact, isn't there, that apparently she literally left her mark. So if you dig down, there's a layer of red sediment, which is
from her burning.
Yeah.
So she's the first of in a line of female rulers that we talk about in the book, which include Cleopatra, Elizabeth I, and Catherine the Great. And they were celebrated as anomalies because it was so unusual for women to be in positions of power. And Tacitus, as I say, the most reliable source about her, was really obsessed with how weird it was that there was a woman leading an army. He elsewhere talks about all the shrieking that there was because women were allowed on the battlefields in Britain, and this like horrified him. But the Romans were particularly sensitive to this because they didn't think that women were logical enough to handle high-stress leadership roles. And they were very sensitized to this by Cleopatra. Everything that happened with her kind of sex and death thing had really freaked them out. But Tacitus was himself grudgingly impressed with how Boudicca dealt with what he acknowledged was extreme dishonor.
Yeah. I mean, so obviously the offences against Boudicca are much more serious than anything we might come up against in our normal working lives. And murder and mutilation are definitely not the response to any everyday problem.
But we saw something in her emphatic response that we thought was inspiring, albeit with less disemboweling and mutilation. Sometimes extreme disrespect does warrant a noisy counterattack. And Boudicca nurtured a very literal no prisoners, take no prisoners attitude. But I think she can act as a source of encouragement for those of us who struggle with expressing dissent. She wasn't worried about making enemies. She wasn't worried about causing a scene. She was confident in her own authority, and that meant that other tribes rallied around her when she started her rebellion. We can't claim she had a happy ending. The Romans turned out to be pretty good at fighting.
As well as construction, aqueducts, the legal system.
Underfloor heating.
That's right.
but the Roman emperor did actually rethink his policy for colonising Britain and go with a less aggressive kind of stance on it after her revolt because it was so significant to them. She died by suicide, Boudicca, to avoid capture. And to add insult to injury, her name has been misspelt for quite a long time as Boadicea, and that is apparently due to a kind of a typo, essentially, in one of Tacitus's manuscripts being copied when they were copied by one person to another. And legend has it she's buried between platforms 9 and 10 at King's Cross Station, so she's apparently very near here. The ambiguities in her story mean that she's been repurposed as a symbol for many different causes. We don't know whether she was pro or anti-empire. We don't know whether her concerns were primarily political or domestic. Was she a war hero? Was she a war criminal? What would you think about Brexit? her reputation lives on because the UK loves an underdog. And also because she categorically refused to be swept aside by the more powerful forces that were in play at her time. So sometimes it's the nice thing to do, to be nice and back down, but sometimes it's important to fight for what you believe in.
Absolutely. So next up is Sappho, who's another figure whose reputation sustains despite the sort of best efforts of history to erase it. Sappho is someone else who went her own way, and in our book we talk about her and backing yourself. So when it comes to criticism, we believe there's no one nastier than ourselves. It's very easy to beat yourself up when the meeting doesn't go to plan or a deal doesn't come off, but instead of sort of throwing ourselves down a well of self-hate, what if there was another way, and how do we go about shushing that belittling inner voice? We think Sappho has something to tell us about accepting ourselves, warts and all. She was a literary sort of smash in her own time, an ancient Greek poet who had 9 volumes of her work at the very famous Library of Alexandria. And the librarians there named her as the only woman in their roster of 9 prime poets.
Mm. And even Plato, who was not a big fan of poetry, called her the 10th muse.
But by the Middle Ages, almost everything of hers had disappeared. It's partly to do with like the ravages of time. So that library at Alexandria suffered a huge fire in which all sort of original documentation was lost. It's partly to do with the fact that she wrote in a very particular dialect, which by the Middle Ages had died out. But blame also has to lie at the feet of some of the clergymen of the Middle Ages, who were totally freaked by the sort of joyous sexuality that's right there in her poems.
One of them called her a sex-crazed whore who sings of her own wantonness, which is not what you see on the back of the Penguin Classics edition.
Absolutely. But in the last 2 decades, sort of fragments of her poems have been rediscovered, and they revealed whole sections of Sappho's rhymes. And it's really interesting that people immediately knew that this was a sapphic, that it was Sappho, because she had invented the sapphic stanza.
Yeah, and you have to be pretty confident in yourself to feel that you need to invent a new poetic form to express your genius.
Yeah. So all aspects of her life have been the subject of sort of feverish speculation over the years. The truth is we don't know very much about her. We don't know what her sexuality was. We don't know who her family were. But what we do know is that she's associated with the liberal island of Lesbos. But because attitudes to homosexuality in ancient times are so different to how we might consider them now, it's very difficult to say if she was a lesbian or not. Ovid, who's a Roman poet, about 500 years later, came up with the theory that she ran kind of romantic finishing schools for girls, that she was teaching them the art of love through her poems. But what's amazing is, even though we know nothing, what we do have are these poems, and what sort of sings out at us across the millennia is this incredible voice and her sort of feelings about love and romance. There's a very famous, slightly uninspiringly titled poem called Fragment 31. And the setup is she's watching on jealously as some man flirts with this beautiful girl. And she talks about, it's just an incredible articulation of desire and jealousy. She talks about her sweating palms and her ears are thrumming, her blood kind of pulsing in her veins. And what's amazing is that she's really in touch with her feelings about love. There's no fear of that emotional vulnerability. She sort of owns her weaknesses and her fallibilities.
And she does the same in another poem where she talks about aging, and she talks about her kind of knackered knees and her sagging skin, and that's not something that she feels she needs to hide or...
Exactly. So we've got some rules about backing yourself. First of all, it's good to remember that nobody's perfect. In fact, imperfection are sort of traits shared by all the very best people through history. We're bound to come up against other people's judgment, just as Sappho's work did. But you should try to stand strong on that. And remember, it doesn't matter what you look like as long as your soul is in really good shape. So Sappho had a great line that says, a handsome man guards his image a while, a good man will one day take on beauty.
So we're pitching our book as kind of inspiring and hoping that it fills readers with kind of vim and vigour to take on the issues of the modern world with these great role models. But it did also strike us that a book of 50 really high achieving women who changed the world might actually make us feel a bit inadequate. And our next heroine is actually someone who makes me feel quite inadequate. So she is the 18th century interpreter and explorer Sacagawea. And there's no way that I could do what she did, which is travel thousands of miles through uncharted territory with a new baby strapped to her back the whole time. And I really hate camping, so that is clearly out of my comfort zone. But we do think there's also a broader message to be taken from her life. So Sacagawea was born, she's a Native American from the Shoshone tribe, and she was born around 1788. And she was the daughter of a chief, but she was kidnapped when she was very young by an enemy tribe called the Hidatsa. And they sold her to be essentially the extra wife of a French Canadian trapper who was the melodiously named Toussaint Charbonneau, who had the incommodious reputation of being a right stinker. He was described in reports of the time as a man of no particular merit and apparently an attempted rapist. But of course, we have no records of what Sacagawea thought of being married to this guy. In 1804, the US president decided that he wanted a military expedition to explore the uncolonized west of the continent. And the leaders of that expedition arrived in Sacagawea's village. And they had the grandiose name, the Corps of Discovery.
I always think that's funny, the Corps of Discovery, they're basically missing the fact that it was not an undiscovered land for all of the natives.
People who already lived there.
Yeah, exactly. The
Corps was led by Captain Lewis and Lieutenant Clark, and they were keen to find interpreters to help them on their journey, particularly as they were going up the Missouri River into potentially deadly territory. And Charbonneau and Sacagawea between them could speak French, Hidatsa and Shoshone, and so they were employed by Lewis and Clark, even though at that point Sacagawea was heavily pregnant with her first child. And in fact, the expedition set off just 2 months after she had had her baby. So she had her little boy, Jean-Baptiste, and then she strapped into her back. She was 17 years old. She set off on an all-male expedition, about 60 men and just her, carrying him on her back, travelling all the way to the Pacific, mainly by boat. And it was her survival skills and her geographical knowledge which contributed a lot to that expedition.
And there's that famous story, isn't there, where she had to jump in and her husband capsized the canoe at one point. She had to jump in and rescue their supplies.
Yeah. So it was a really tough journey. They were kind of beset by illness. There was the threat of attack from hostile locals. There were grizzly bears. One man did actually die. But Sacagawea made it all the way to the Pacific and then all the way back again. And this expedition helped the mapping of the West and the eventual expansion of the United States, and she was a key player in that. So sometimes the constant recalibration of work-life balance can feel impossible, but I think Sacagawea's story puts this into perspective. Most of us these days don't get kidnapped, get to choose who we marry, get to choose whether or not we want to try and have kids as a starting point. And travelling thousands of miles with a two-month-old on your back certainly puts the school run into perspective for us. It's hard to find a better example of an unstoppable heroine to kind of pep up your spirits and make you feel like anything is possible.
Absolutely. Okay, so our next heroine is Enhedjuana, and we talk about her and creativity. So obviously we're here in Google, we don't need to tell you anything about creativity, but what if meetings and WhatsApp groups and the kind of constant deluge of millions of emails is crushing it, and you can't find the time for your creative juices to flow? Well, we know that feeding your inner imagineer leads to huge rewards. Your jobs are better, you can ease your relationship tensions, it can make you genuinely feel more alive and fulfilled. And Enhedjuana is an ancient Mesopotamian priestess who took it a step further. She didn't just revel in her creativity, she owned it.
And she lived around 4.5 millennia ago, so she is the most ancient lady in our book.
Yeah. So this is a bit difficult to say, but she was basically the daughter of the King Sargon of Akkad, who appointed her high priestess of the moon god Nanna and the goddess Inanna in the holy city of Ur, which is a bit of a mouthful. But anyway, that is in southern Iraq. So her father, the king, was trying to unite warring kind of empire states by putting his daughter at the center in the holiest role. She obviously took her responsibility seriously and was good at it, because we know she remained in the job for over 40 years. And she bagged herself the claim in that 40 years of being history's first recorded writer.
So the first recorded writer, either man or woman, in the planet's history.
Yeah, which I'm still staggered by as a fact. We know a lot about her because of her creative legacy. There's a body of work that she left behind in the hymns and poems that she constructed. And there's also a sort of fabulous stone engraving called the Disc of Enhedjuana, which depicts her taking part in a ritual.
And she has a kind of bald, crouching priest at her feet. And she has amazing braids and a turban. And she's clearly a woman at the top of her game in that.
Yeah. So the poems and hymns show us her character. Her poems are kind of amazing because they have a proper narrative arc. And this is 4,500 years ago. But there's one in particular that talks about a political threat she suffers. And she begs her goddess for the power to wreak her revenge. By the end of the poem, she's back in her proper position as the holiest priestess. So there are loads of amazing things in this poem.
We particularly like the line, mistress of heaven with the great pectoral jewels.
But most astonishing is her sort of sense of authorship and ownership. Again, she's the first recorded person to use the first person. And she does it in these lines where she says, I am Enhedjuana. And she says, I've given birth to this song for you. And I love that line because it gives a sort of feminine kind of slant to this idea of the process of creativity. And it's worth remembering she was doing all of this about a millennium and a half before Homer was tackling the Iliad and the Odyssey. So she has, I think, all the traits that we associate with really creative people. She was original, inventive, passionate, committed, fiery. And all of that is doable. I suppose the thing to remember is we don't have to all be in the business of laying down art that will remain for centuries to feel that we're being creative. We think it's to do with everyday creativity. And for me, that means just generally asking more questions about everything. But it could also be about trying to be just more spontaneous in your daily life, disrupting your everyday patterns in different ways.
So the next lesson we have comes from what seems like a slightly unlikely place, but covers an issue that I think haunts a lot of people for far less significant reasons than it might have haunted famous concubine Nell Gwynn, had she been that way inclined. And what we learned from Nell was how to ride out shame and embarrassment and stop apologising for ourselves all the time. So Eleanor Gwynn's origins are not 100% clear, but she was thought to have been born in 1650. She grew up in Covent Garden. Her mother ran a brothel. As a teenager, she got a job selling oranges at what's now the Theatre Royal in Drury Lane. And those were very exciting times in kind of theatrical circles, because the theatres had been closed down for 11 years by Oliver Cromwell, and the king had just recently been restored to the throne. And as part of reopening the theatres, he also allowed women to act on the stage for the first time, because obviously in Shakespeare's time and around that, only men could act on the stage. And this opened the stage door for Nell, who became the best known and most celebrated comic actress of her day, and she was reviewed by Samuel Pepys as Pretty Witty Nell.
But and then there was a slightly ruder moment, wasn't there, where he called her a bold, merry slut.
Yes, she starred in plays by the likes of Dryden, and she was admired by people like Aphra Behn and the Earl of Rochester. And she had three boyfriends called Charles, and the most significant of these was the King, Charles II, who ensured her lasting fame. She met him in 1669, and by the next year she had given birth to his child. And Charles set her up in a house in Pall Mall, and one day he was there at the house visiting her and the children, and he heard Nell call their oldest son by saying, "Come here, you little bastard." And that moved him to formally acknowledge the boy as his son and set him up as an earl. Mm. So Nell was quite shrewd in the way that she handled the king. Mm. She became one of his most popular mistresses because she certainly wasn't the only one. Charles had about 14 illegitimate children with a pretty much about the same number of women. And Nelly became his kind of bit of rough at this time, but he also had a posher mistress called Louise de Kerouel at the same time, and she was now thought probably to have been a French spy. And Nell really loved winding her up, so she used to call her the Weeping Willow because she was quite an emotional person.
But I think there's evidence that they liked hanging out together as well. They played cards and ate macaroons together.
Yeah, so it wasn't all handbags. So Nell and Charles kept their romance alive until the king's death. And on his deathbed, his famous last words were to ask his brother, the soon-to-be King James II, not to let poor Nelly starve. So James, you know, went along with this, and he set Nelly up very comfortably, and she lived very happily until she died quite young of a stroke when she was just 38, and she's buried in St. Martin in the Fields Church. What made her such an excellent companion? It was her shamelessness. She didn't care about going along with respectable feminine ideals, and she wasn't ashamed of the kind of odd role that she had in society. She seems to have been a loyal friend. She certainly seems to have had a lot of fun. She used to zoom around in a sedan chair, eating oysters and macaroons. She bought herself a silver bed with the king's face carved in it. So she certainly made the most of her position. There was one time where she was caught in an angry crowd in her carriage, and the kind of mob around her were protesting because they thought that Louise, who was very unpopular, was in the carriage. And so she leant out the window and shouted, "I'm the Protestant whore," because Louise would have been the Catholic one. And the crowd then dispersed in quite a cheery way because they were, you know, entertained by Nell. She was very entertaining. So the best lesson we learnt from her was not to be so easily ashamed of setbacks and to put ourselves out there despite the risk of embarrassment, and to make sure that we take time to enjoy the good things in life, like macaroons.
Yes, absolutely. So next we move on to imposter syndrome, which we think is the pernicious underminer of talented people everywhere. So this is the idea that no matter how brilliant you are, no matter how professional you are, you believe that compliments are lies and you're probably only one step away from being handed your P45. So how to deal with it? It's difficult, but there's one historical homemaker, Isabella Beaton, who maybe ought to have felt imposter syndrome, but seems to have laughed in the face of it and got on with achieving stuff. So when I think of as Isabella Beaton before we came to research her for this book, I thought of this matronly lady stalking the halls of some country house in her crinolines with a dish, shouting at the servants. But in fact, it is true that her book, her famous book of household management, does have some really deadly tips. There's one where she says, "When a mistress is an early riser, it's almost certain that her house will be orderly and well managed. On the contrary, if she remain in bed till a late hour, then the servants are likely to become sluggards."
Can we particularly object to that one?
Yeah. But actually, she was this really young, forward-thinking entrepreneur. She was a translator, she was a journalist, she was an editor. And the brilliant thing about her is that she was really rubbish at cooking, which was a surprise to me. She was married to a publisher, and she wrote articles for his magazine. And her first contributions were columns on cookery and pickling and preserving. And they proved to be a massive hit, despite the fact that she couldn't cook.
Yeah, and she actually even missed out the flour in her first cake recipe, and she had to print an apology the next week because she had missed out the flour.
The other thing about her is that she actually stole most of her recipes. So she'd been told by somebody that culinary expertise took decades to kind of gather, and she decided she didn't have time to waste doing that, so she just nicked them, basically, and made very good use of the lax copyright laws at the time. But what she did bring one really original thing to sort of recipe making, which was she sort of invented recipes, actually. So she was the person who invented writing them in a list so that you knew which ingredients you needed to have to hand before you got on with it.
Yeah, she doesn't specify measuring them out into aspirational ceramics like on Bake Off, but we think she would have approved.
She probably
of that,
would have probably. Done. Yeah. So her husband, ever the opportunistic publisher, realised he had hot property, and he cooked up the idea of Mrs. Beaton's book of household management. It was a massive bestseller, and actually it's still in print today, nearly 150 years later. So what was the genius of it was it wasn't just the sort of 2,000 recipes it contains. It also had tips on child rearing, on boundary property law, on menu planning. So she was teaching the sort of the generation of women around her how to manage a household. So after her death, she died again. This is the thing I hadn't realised. She died very young. She was 28 when she died, She died after contracting an infection after the birth of her fourth child. And basically, it was one of those moments where after her death, her fame grew even more. And you still find it on people's cookery shelves today. But what I love about her is she's this kind of dynamic woman who built this brand for domestic goddessness. But she was anything but, really anything but. So if you're suffering from imposter syndrome, as I quite often do, I look to Isabella and I think about the way that she styled it out. She sort of understood that the path to success lies in taking risks and not being afraid of your mistakes, and in fact realizing that our flaws are no barrier to being completely amazing.
Mm-hmm. So this is our last woman, and with Josephine Baker we've looked at the issue of having it all. Now, in the media, having it all is usually used as a coded phrase to say that women can't or shouldn't have what men have. And as a female, you're usually expected, if you're having it all, then that means you are effortlessly combining an Instagrammable home, a loving, passionate relationship with your partner, a stimulating and high-powered career, and also you look amazing. And actually, the life of celebrated dancer and singer Josephine Baker actually does tick all those boxes. She sets a very high bar. But she certainly didn't achieve everything that she achieved easily. It wasn't given to her on a plate. She was born in poverty in St. Louis in 1906. And as a child, she had to miss school in order to go out to work so that the family could pay the bills. And she started dancing on the street and in clubs when she was a young teenager. And despite people telling her that she was too dark and too skinny, she got really good. She joined a dance troupe. Her natural charm and abilities led her to Broadway, and it was from there that she got her really amazing big break, which is that the company that she worked with when she was 19 decided to go on tour in Paris. In 1920s, Paris was fascinated with the Harlem Renaissance, with American jazz and primitivism, and Josephine's dance number there, which was called the Danse Sauvage, required her to dance essentially only wearing a feather skirt, and audiences loved it. Obviously, this fetishization of African culture feels wrong today, but she grabbed that opportunity that she had. And she used to drive around in a Rolls Royce with her pet cheetah, Chiquita, wearing lots of diamonds. And then she went on to take on the act that made her really, truly famous, which is a sort of spirited twerking number where she just wears a belt made of sparkling bananas.
And from this point, she became a complete sensation. She was the most highly paid entertainer in Europe, which is no mean feat for a black American woman. She had hundreds of marriage proposals. She was admired by Hemingway, Picasso, Frida Kahlo, Colette.
And then she went on to train really hard to also become an accomplished singer. And she became the first woman of color in kind of major motion pictures as well. Sadly, when she returned on a tour to the US, her home country was not ready to accept a beautiful, rich, talented black woman in this way, and she met with quite racist reviews. And so when she came back to France the next year in 1937, she became a French citizen. And her devotion to her new country was really passionate. When World War II started, she worked with the resistance, and she actually used to smuggle secrets around in her sheet music and her underwear because she was able to travel as an entertainer in a particular way that was helpful to the resistance. And after the war, she was presented with many honors for her service. One of the things I loved when I was researching her is that if you find clips of her speaking voice, it's completely heavenly and extraordinary. But there are also amazing photos of her receiving her medals from the French government with her children. And her children were another kind of key part of her story. So after distressing experiences trying to have a baby, she ended up adopting 12 different children from different countries, different races and religions. And besides her wish to be a mother, she also had a political purpose in this, in that she wanted to build a rainbow tribe in order to prove that people from diverse backgrounds could get along.
And she made her chateau into a sort of theme park where people could come and see her children and see the rainbow tribe together, which is a good intention, but must have been a very weird experience
very strange.
To have as a child.
Yeah. But linked to this project of hers, she also in the 50s became active in the civil rights movement in the US. She refused to play to segregated audiences in Las Vegas. And there was a famous incident in the Stork Club in Manhattan where they refused to serve her and she kicked up a huge fuss. And this got her in a lot of trouble. She was labeled as a commie troublemaker. She was investigated by the FBI because of it.
Yeah, and I suppose it's that thing that linked to today. It's sort of depressing that a woman kicking up a fuss, speaking her mind about a perceived injustice is still something that even now we see is met with disproportionate criticism. But there was a happy outcome to the Stork Club incident, which is that she formed a lasting friendship with Grace Kelly, who happened to be there and walked out at the same time. And that's something we found again and again through our book. It's these instances where women support other women and good stuff comes out of that.
Yeah, because even later when Josephine actually, the cost of running the kind of amazing chateau theme park sent her bankrupt, and Princess Grace gave her a house in Monaco so that she could look after her. And then it was only in 1973 that Josephine finally got the applause she wanted from the United States when she did a performance at Carnegie Hall, which was kind of rapturously received. And not long after that, she did another big grand performance in Paris to celebrate the first anniversary of her dancing there. And it was only a few days later that she died, and she was found dead in her bed with her amazing reviews all scattered around her. Mm. 20,000 people lined the streets for her funeral, and she was buried with full military honours.
So did she have it all, though?
Yeah.
That's the question.
I mean, when you look at her rags-to-riches tale and her professional excellence and the lovely pictures of her cute kids in the castle, it looks like it, but she took a lot of fire from people who saw her as an upstart, people who saw her four failed marriages, thought she was a bizarre mother, a political loose cannon. Obviously, she went bankrupt. Now she's recognised as the unique and powerful performer that she is, and as a brave war hero, civil rights activist, and a style icon.
Yeah, there are these great pictures of her in her huge sunglasses in late life. She's wonderful.
And her influence endures. She's inspired lots of people, including Beyoncé. Most of us would be immensely proud to have anything near the kind of life that Josephine had. But she did work unbelievably hard to get it, and she suffered a lot of setbacks. I'm sure at various points she didn't know that the end result would be this incredible career. So it was very liberating for us to realise that having it all means only going for what you want on your own terms, to the best of your particular abilities, and accepting that things will always keep changing. And that is certainly something that Josephine did.
So that's it. That's our 10 women from the past who we believe can help our present in really tangible, concrete ways. We have there a queen, an inventor, a spy, a warrior, a poet, an explorer, a priestess, a concubine, a cook, and a dancer. All much more exciting jobs than most of us can have. But all these women excelled at what they put their energies into, and all of them left their mark. And they certainly raised our sense of what's possible, and they raised our spirits as well.
We had a really joyful time writing the book and working with the illustrator Bijou Carmen, whose work you've seen behind us today. And we hope that you and perhaps aunties, sisters, you know, daughters enjoy it, and that it gives you an amusing few hours and solves all of your problems.
Thank you so much for having us.
Thank you.
So we have time for some questions, if anyone has any.
How did you go about your research and deciding who would be in the book?
Yeah, so the decision making was one of the hardest, but also one of the most fun bits of it. We actually have a list of about 290 other women, and it's called Spare Ladies. It's a document that we have on our thing.
So it turns out women have been doing really great things for a really long time.
Yeah. So we came up with a list of modern dilemmas that we thought were worth answering, and then we came up with a list of women, and we were really clear that we wanted the women to be representative of all different countries, but also all different disciplines. So not, you know, we both work in the publishing industry, so our natural instinct was to go with lots of writers and artists. But in fact, we wanted scientists in there and explorers and all those
sportswomen
and all those other facets. And then just a quick look at a woman's life, and you'd immediately see the little point that answered the modern dilemma, and that was the sort of springboard for us to then go off and research them more fully. So there's definitely people we regret leaving out. Marie Curie's not in there.
Yeah.
Maya Angelou. Yeah. Feel bad about her.
You feel bad about Mary Queen of Scots.
I do feel bad about Mary Queen of Scots. But maybe for volume two.
What inspired you on this subject? Like, now we know, I was gonna ask, like, what do you do? But you work in publishing, but why did you pick this subject?
So it genuinely came from watching the women's marches post the election in America. We were really inspired by all those placards about nasty women, and the way that women were kind of reclaiming it as from an insult into a positive term. So we originally thought of it as a book celebrating the kind of nasty women of the past, and a lot of the women in our book are sort of difficult and complex, and that was something else we wanted to highlight. They're not perfect, any of these women. They're sort of bad mothers or
alcoholics, bad girlfriends.
Exactly. Yeah. And we really wanted to we wanted to show that these aren't kind of bastions of perfection. But then we also, as we said, wanted to take it a step further and see, is there a way that these amazing nasty women from the past can help us with modern dilemmas? So that was where it came from.
Do you have a favorite?
Yeah, Josephine's one of my favourites.
And
actually,
I think Isabella Beaton is one of mine. But I also, I do love Sappho as well. Yeah, no, you can't. It was a very joyful experience to write this book, and yeah, they all were genuinely.
Mae West
inspired.
Is really good too, actually.
Yeah, she's
Mae
great. And Frida Kahlo's amazing.
See,
as
that's
well,
the thing. Once yeah, once you start, it's very difficult.
Do you get quoted on that?
Yeah.
There's a children's book, you might know, Goodnight Stories for Rebel Girls, which is doing a sort of fairly similar thing. What do you think is different about what you're going for?
I think the main thing is that ours is for a kind of older audience. So we have swearing in our book. And I love Goodnight Stories.
It's
is a brilliant book. And my children read it and your children read it, don't they? But the premise of that is to present these women's stories as fairy tales. And in a way, what we wanted to do was quite different to that, in that we are depicting them warts and all. And we are looking at adult problems in relation to their lives. Mm. So, I mean, that book is a gorgeous and wonderful book, and we sort of hope this is a kind of slightly older sister to it.
Yeah, yes, that's a good way of putting it. But yeah, we have some really difficult women in it. So Coco Chanel, who I think is also in Goodnight Stories, and what they don't talk about is her sort of Nazi sympathising past as well, because obviously
it's for children.
But we do confront that in the book, and kind of, and then another figure who we really denied over putting in there was Mary Stopes, because she held some really dodgy kind of world views at the time. But again, that was really intentional. We thought long and hard about that. We wanted difficult women in there as well. Yeah, we didn't want to sugarcoat it.
I'm just curious, what is the most poignant lesson that you each have taken away from, you know, all the various chapter problems?
I mean, I think for me, it really is this idea of women helping other women, because that's something that we had. And actually, to be fair, also, there are lots of great dads and brothers and husbands in this book who are really instrumental in allowing these women or helping these women achieve what they achieved.
Yeah, there's a lot of fathers who refuse to accept that their daughters couldn't have a decent education.
Yeah.
So they would educate them privately or find other ways to kind of instill education in them. And that was very moving, wasn't it?
It was, yeah. That they had to step outside of what was supposed to be allowed for girls, and the father supported them in that. But we have, so the Princess Grace and Josephine one's something that we love, but also we talk about the tennis player Althea Gibson, and she has an amazing kind of mentor relationship with someone
who
really
like
helped
her. Yeah, so she was like the first black woman to win Wimbledon in the 50s. And just there, it's really moving that there are certain moments during her life where just women sort of swooped in and really helped her. So one of the white champions at the time wrote this open letter to a magazine to say, come on guys, why don't we let her into the Lawn Tennis Association? And that was a great moment. And then later in her life, when she'd sort of fallen foul of the American healthcare system, again, another woman swooped in and raised a load of money to pay for her healthcare. So that was really moving, that sense of women helping each other.
You say that you're very intentional in distributing through different regions, times in history, but you also say that you have 290 spare women. Mm. Is there any particular time in history or region that stands out for having a lot of women in that period?
I mean, I think what we tried not to do, because ultimately what you do end up with when you look at these lists is quite a lot of Victorian white women.
Yeah, that's where the records are.
Yeah, that's where the records are. That seems to be where women suddenly did start to change the world.
And rich Victorian white women.
Rich Victorian, very wealthy Victorian white women.
So that's why there are queens in all of these books, because there's loads of documentation about them. So obviously it makes the research is richer.
And we were really clear that we didn't want to do that.
We
wanted to go to slightly unusual places in the world and also in history and see what lessons you could draw from those
There were women
places.
We discovered for the first time in writing the book, and that's something that we wanted to do, was find out about people that we'd never heard of. And so we have quite a few of them, as well as having the big famous ones.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.